Postponement of the unity rally in Iloilo comes after it had to reschedule another sortie in Antique province amid strong objection by residents. The event was supposed to be held in the town of San Jose de Buenavista, where the late Antique governor Evilio Bihavier was killed in 1986 by men, allegedly upon orders from a local ally of Ferdinand Marcos Sr. The killing of Governor Javier is being touted as among the tipping points that led to the EDSA People Power Revolution. Joining us this morning for more on this is Gideon Javier, the son of the slain governor. Gideon, thank you for speaking to us as we mark 36 years since the first EDSA People Power Revolution.
Good morning, Mike. Thanks for having me.
All right. Sir, tell us what went through your mind when you found out that the Marcos team intended to hold a campaign event on the spot where your father was killed.
Well, I was shocked. I was extremely shocked and angry because the stage is literally about two car lengths away from the rock my father was sitting on when Marcos gunmen started shooting at him. They didn't shoot him like once. They actually hit him piece by piece and drove him down the street and really tortured him as they were killing him. So, I mean, it was another form of torture to have the son of the man responsible and the son of the woman who actually paid for it with money from her bedroom.
Let's talk about that in a bit, but there was a lot of pushback against the event and the Marcos team said they will reschedule it. Will you oppose a future activity if held elsewhere in the province of Antique?
Everyone has a right to hold their political events. There's nothing legally wrong with doing your campaigns anywhere. But it's also a question of delicadeza and basic morality. I mean, if you kill somebody and then you hold a rally right on the spot, I don't know what that says about you, your morals, or you as a person.
Mm-hmm. Take us back to the day when your father was killed in February 1986. How did you find out about what happened to your father? And how did that event affect your family?
Well, my father had brought us to the United States to be safe. We got a call from my mother's brother who said, my father had been killed. And then we just gathered in the dark. It was late at night. On a Sunday there, it was a Monday here. And we just huddled together.
Mm-hmm. And the prime suspect was your father's rival, former Assemblyman Arturo Pacificador, who according to a ledger in Malacanang obtained by the Los Angeles Times, supposedly received 5 million pesos from the Marcoses, or 1 million pesos from the Marcoses 5 days after the killing. Did you think at that time, when your father was killed, did you think that it was just Pacificador who was behind the killing, or did you already suspect that it went all the way up to the former dictator?
In those days, Marcos would have lists of people he would want eliminated. We pretty much knew that it went all the way up and then it was scripted because you do not do something so brazen unless you have clearance from above.
It was a brazen. Go ahead, sir.
17 people. It involved two vehicles that they saw. It involved a helicopter that was looking for him at night. It was a full-on concerted effort by the Philippine government or the Marcos regime. The cars were from DPWH. The armed forces probably supplied the helicopter. The assault rifles provided probably came from the Philippine Constabulary. It was a full-on assassination job.
Mm-hmm. But those who were charged only included Pacificador and some of the men below him. And Pacificador himself was acquitted in 2004 after 18 years, supposedly because he wasn't present on the site where your father was gunned down. He eventually died in 2015, but he was able to serve in government after he was actually imprisoned. So there were some who were also convicted, but do you feel that your family got justice after all these decades for what happened to your father?
I do not think my family got justice at all. On one hand, the trial was manhandled and maneuvered by various political personalities. On the other hand, Pacificador was running around the country free for many years before being officially surrendered. I think it was 6 or 7 years that he was out there going everywhere, being seen by everyone. And then, like, all these personalities came in and interfered with the trial. And then, to make things worse, they went through changes of judges because of the length of the trial. And the last judge to come in was from the same hometown as Pacificador. Pacificador is not from Antique. He's from Pototan in Iloilo. A year before his not guilty verdict, the judge was changed to someone also from Pototan, Iloilo.
Did you also try to go after the Marcoses, after the discovery that there was a ledger, supposedly, of the payment by the Marcoses to Pacificador?
I have not really been a politician, a lawyer, or anyone in a capacity to do these things. I've been a private citizen. We protest when they do things like this, but we do not really have that capacity that government people, lawyers, and other people like that have to go after them.
Now, your father's death was credited as being among the tipping points of the 1986 EDSA People Power Revolution, which happened only a few days after his death. Do you feel the same way, though? I mean, that somehow his death led to a much bigger change in Philippine society, that it wasn't all in vain.
Yes. When my father died, we were already very angry. Even before that, we had been so terrorized by Marcos, and that people were risking their lives to get rid of Marcos. And when my father died, the people who were leading the fight against Marcos said, "May we show your father's body around Manila to show what they've done?" And we were still processing our grief, but we said, yes, this has to happen. More people will die. So it was a very painful experience to go through, losing our father, but also having to agree, and just for the sake of this country to be free again.
Mm-hmm. And what do you make now of another Marcos possibly occupying Malacañang 36 years after they were ousted?
It is once again a threat to our democracy. Behind him are all the people who like to do things to destroy democracy so they can make money, be in power, act like kings. It's not just about Marcos. It's about all the people that he brings who are expecting their golden age of whatever they did to destroy this country for their own benefit.
Mm-hmm. Lastly, Gideon, what do you make of those of the defense that's being used by supporters of the Marcoses, saying that, you know, the EDSA People Power Revolt was just about the battle between the Aquinos and the Marcoses, that it wasn't really the voice of the people? How do you intend to address that?
We weren't Aquino, like, stalwarts. My father was working for Eva Estrada Calao, another opposition senator. We were all united in our opposition to Marcos. There were several different opposition candidates, Doy Laurel, Eva Estrada Calao, and others. And really, just for the good of the country, they said, let us unite behind one person. And it was Cory, because she didn't have any particular clique or interests. So after, like, of course, she had a couple of relatives, but, you know, she was more than anything the rallying symbol for everyone after EDSA, which also explains why she wasn't really governing with a fully established team who had been with her for a long time, simply because everyone just got together to get rid of Marcos and then fill the vacuum afterwards.
So how do you feel about the revisionist stance taken by some on social media discrediting the EDSA People Power Revolution?
As someone who actually had to study history and to become very, very precise or else to be discredited, and to have earned my credentials in understanding these things, these people make me sick. They are, they're illegitimate. They are outright liars. They make me wonder what else they lie in their lives.
All right. We'll have to leave it at that. Thank you so much for joining us this morning, Mr. Gideon Javier.
Thank you, Mike.